was just able to join us. We are live here from Sepang International Circuit. We are talking to the CEO of Sepang International Circuit, Dato' Razak Al-Ghazali. Thank you for joining us today, Dato'. Firstly, congratulations on you. This is the first time you guys have completely sold out the MotoGP. Am I right?
Yeah, it's quite unprecedented this year. The ticket sales have been flying off the shelf. As we inform everybody that we sold out all our grandstand tickets last Monday. 3 weeks to go before Malaysia MotoGP. It's just unbelievable.
Yeah. And so let's say if somebody wants to buy a ticket now,
like only Hillstand tickets.
Only Hillstand. So there's, is there still quite a lot of tickets to buy for these guys?
Hillstand tickets, you know, being a Hillstand, it can fit a lot of people.
Yeah.
Although we have targeted to be about 20,000, I think we sold quite a fair bit already.
Okay.
But that's the only ticket category that's available.
So how many tickets in total can you sell?
Oh, all the grandstands are all sold out, obviously. Like I said, Hillstands are technically, it's a deal.
Yeah.
You can fit 20, 30, 40,000.
Yeah.
You know, so we're targeting 20,000.
Right.
So because our target is to try to aspire to reach 90,000 on Sunday.
Wow.
Yeah.
Total?
Total.
And for the complete weekend, how many thousands?
We're talking about in excess of 150,000 over 3 days.
So last year was?
Last year was slightly below that. But I think we anticipate to be more.
So if somebody wants to buy a ticket now, where can they go and get a ticket?
They can still go to our ticket booth in New Central, in Tropicana, KLCC, even here in Sepang. Online is still available, but it's instant tickets.
Right. Okay. So moving on, you know, MotoGP has been such a success in the Malaysian round of MotoGP. But in contrast, Formula One is so different. So is it just the type of market that Malaysia is, or why do you think this is so?
Well, I think it's the sport itself. MotoGP tend to be more exciting.
Mm-hmm.
The races are awesome.
Yeah.
From round one onwards, it's been a crazy fight in all categories.
Yeah.
And of course, to have Malaysians in the Moto2 and Moto3 makes it extra special for Malaysia to watch.
Yeah.
You know, in almost until the last round, there's seven different winners for MotoGP.
Yeah.
You know? Although Moto3 is concluded, but we always want to see whether Khairul Ilham Pahwi can do that magic in Malaysia.
Yeah.
Adam Nordheim always wants to search for his second top 10 or in the points at least. Hafiz Syahrin looking for his first podium.
Mm-hmm.
And Sepang is the best place to do it. And of course, the fight between the big boys, Rossi and Marquez and all that. And of course, who could forget last year's incident? So people want to see whether they're going to repeat of all this.
So Malaysians can relate to it because they are Malaysians on track.
I believe so. That is part of it. And of course, Malaysians being fanatics of two wheels,
mm-hmm.
That also helps. But again, you know, I mean, Malaysia MotoGP has been around in Malaysia for 26 years. 27 years, and why is it the last 5 years is picking up so big? I think it's a combination. You have one event at MotoGP where the excitement, the product is growing tremendously, and you have another pinnacle motorsport of four wheels that is, you know, slowly stagnating, slowly on the decline, not doing much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that is a big factor.
So, but you also have, I mean, Sepang Circuit is starting to become as synonymous with concerts as it is with motorsport. Does that have something to do with it? You had Usher for Formula One. Who are we going to see for MotoGP?
Well, the thing is, we never had any concert with MotoGP and it's selling well.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that should be the way. You know, the government, the country spend a lot of money on rights fees to bring both Formula One and MotoGP.
Mm-hmm.
We should be able to sell it on its own.
Yeah.
And at the same time, some activities, non-motorsport activities, to complement the races, but to the extent of going to get international ladies artists where you spend more money, you know, so that people can go, I think it defeats the purpose of having this F1 or the likes of F1. With MotoGP, you know, we have a Rockaway. It complements them, it complements us. Separate ticket prices, you know, it's just like, oh, by the way, there's a Scorpion concert or a Rockaway concert, but it's not a driving factor.
Right.
It's not a factor for people to wait for a concert before they buy MotoGP, whereby Formula One, who's the artist before I buy the ticket to watch the artist and F1?
Yeah. It's just a by the way thing.
Correct, yeah.
But moving on to the circuit, you now have new hospitality suites in North and South. Are these open now?
Oh, of course, we opened up to Formula One 2 weeks ago.
Right.
It receives tremendous positive reviews.
Mm-hmm.
The team liked it.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, brand new, it's much more comfortable.
Right.
Because of our heat and humidity, in the past, you don't see people sitting outside, but the way we design it, the way the architect designed it, that it's comfortable to sit outside. So you have more people in a paddock sitting outside, which looks nice.
Yeah.
Of course, the south paddock is something that is long outstanding anyway.
Yeah.
And we had so many support races for F1,
yeah.
So GP2 and GP3 teams and driver rated our support paddock as the best in the world.
Wow.
Because other places, they don't get that kind of privilege. So the same with MotoGP.
But these are just a small part of a grander plan for you, for yourself as well.
Small part, but critical for operation purposes. Critical for us to rent out and sell later. So like for example, the south side is a full on, we have full on facilities.
Mm-hmm.
Compared in the past, there's basically nothing.
Okay.
So it's always difficult for us to rent half track, especially on the south, because there's no facilities.
Yeah.
So now we can aggressively sell the track in two configurations simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
It could be cheaper for clients and so on, where they don't have to rent a full track.
Yeah.
You know, but now south and north south, like, there is facilities, which is great for our clients.
Yeah. You are being credited as a man with a plan.
Okay.
So all these things are as part of your master plan as well. There's also word that we are going to see more hotels around Sepang Circuit.
That is the ultimate master plan. Is to have a commercial component to complement our bottom line.
Yeah.
We cannot depend 100% on just motorsports, motorsports events and services and so on. For us to really grow, for SIC to go to the next level, we need to go beyond our comfort zone of being motorsports. We have to look at hotels, at complements, the current facilities, the current business. We need to position SIC as a daily destination for tourism. We aspire to have a amusement park that very specific to automobile or motorsport, because we are unique.
Something like Abu Dhabi.
That is too high end, but yes, in some ways, something like more of a Suzuka concept.
Okay. Besides that, another thing that is new to Sepang this year is a new configuration, the new track. It's not a new configuration, it's a new tunnel. And the last, there's more of a negative camber to the last corner. So are we expecting faster lap times across all?
Well, you've seen a faster lap time for World Superbike. You've seen a faster lap time in all categories that's raced in Sepang since the new asphalt was laid. F1 was 5-6 seconds faster, Porsche Carrera was faster, TCR was faster as well. So we should expect the MotoGP boys to be equally faster as well.
Do you have any feedback to share? Have these guys,
They came and tested. Unfortunately, the weather was against them, and we had a technical drainage issue in one of the turns, and did not dry completely. So it was not a fruitful test for them. But then we keep them in suspense, and we'll find out 2 weeks time.
But I have a question with regards to the Drive M7 SIC team. So who is going to be, for next year, who's going to be with Adam?
That will be announced this weekend. We will be off to Motegi.
Okay.
But I think it's someone that is not, it's not a surprise, it's a familiar face.
Okay.
And those familiar with our program, the Asian Talent Cup program, I think they can relate to this rider.
Nice. So somebody local, somebody international, any hints?
Definitely not local.
Definitely not local.
By Asian.
Yeah. Oh wow, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
And Okay, I think a lot of people want to know this. So, yourself, you're known as a MotoGP fan as well. So, which rider would you support at the MotoGP level?
Oh, my
nationality
goodness.
Aside, I know. Can you share?
To be honest with you, I have not really thought of it. Of course, it would be great to see Rossi win again for the sport. But again, anything can happen this weekend onwards. Because Marc Marquez has a huge lead. But to me, it doesn't really matter for me right now. Who will win in Formula 2? I'm just hoping that the three Malaysians, at least one, will get on the podium.
Yeah. Would the weather help, I guess? Or?
Well, we are still trying to determine the possibilities.
Okay, so I'm done with my questions, but is there any message that you'd like to put across to MotoGP fans here?
Well, guys, we are expecting a sellout crowd on the 30th of October. Please be prepared for transportation, take the public transport, use the Rapid KL, use Uber, use taxis. Traffic's going to be a nightmare. I'm so sorry. You know, when you have 90,000 people coming to Spa Circuit, there's so much that we can do. Hydrate well, come early. Most important, come and watch our Malaysian riders for Moto3 and Moto2.
Thank you, Dato. Thank you. Thank you for watching, guys. See you at MotoGP. Thank you for tuning in.